But until then, we will not stop fighting. Please continue to join us at the stage because our next ceremony is our Fight Back ceremony. The ceremony will educate you in all ways to fight back throughout the year.
Everyone here relays for a different reason. Some people relay for loved ones, others have fought the cancer themselves, and still others relay because they simply care and want to help. All of you are amazing people who are motivated to help beat this horrible disease. Tonight, you are all fighting back, and we thank you.
A lot to me every time. I go through a slew of emotions through relay. I can either scream a lot and like lose my voice or like sit in the corner and cry. It's kind of funny. Watch me throughout the day, and it's kind of entertaining. I hate public speaking. I'm actually really nervous right now. And people yell at me because I'm on stage a lot with the other guys. And they're like, you should not be afraid to be on stage at all. What? Why be scared? And I'm actually the worst public speaker in the world. So thank you, American Cancer Society, for giving a microphone in front of like 500 people. Today, I relay for, I made a list, a man named Rudy Pateri. I met him on a bike ride, and he's passed away. My grandma, Lindsay Kavanagh, and my nurse, Joan. I'd like to tell you a little bit about my cancer story. I am a 4-year testicular cancer survivor. It doesn't get any easier with the years going by. You know, I still am pretty emotional about cancer. It's not so much about my experience anymore as it is about other people's experiences. As a cancer survivor, you are not afraid to talk about cancer to anyone. And so because of that, everyone begins to tell you their story about their friend who was going through chemo, their loved one that just passed away from cancer. So unfortunately, I am a bearer of awful news, but I pray for these people often, and it's a lot to take in. This conversation that I'm supposed to have right now is about fighting back, and fighting back is hard to grasp when you're at relay, and because you do it, it's such a fun thing to do, relay. But fighting back is exactly what you're doing right now, talking about cancer, not being afraid to reach out and talk to that one person that has that silly little prom sash that says survivor, and talk about their story, because their story is pretty unique and pretty amazing. I was diagnosed 4 years ago. I was 17. I was a senior in high school. I was playing soccer at the time, and running down the field became kind of hard. Just things weren't working down there as like they're supposed to. Being a testicular cancer survivor, I can make a lot of jokes about balls now. And so if you got a good one, come up to me. I'd love to entertain it. And people are like, how did you know you had cancer? Well, for me, it was a little different. It's a kind of a rarer form of the tumor that I had. It was a difference between like a grape and a big orange, if you can picture that. Funny. But people always ask me, how'd you know? Because there's a bunch of teenage boys out there who don't know they'll have testicular cancer. So there you go. That's your tidbit. And so because of all these things that were happening in my life, I decided to wait a long time before I told anyone. The reason Lance Armstrong had such a terrible chemo experience was because he waited a long time to tell anyone. And I call that the athlete's mentality, where you're this athlete that thinks nothing can hurt you. And so instead of speaking up on a medical problem, you're gonna try and fight through it, which is awesome. But if you wait really long on cancer, it's gonna get you. However, cool thing about me and Lance, we had the same chemo regimen. So I think I'm just as awesome as he is every day. And then they hopped me into surgery. I love surgery. It's kind of a pet peeve of mine. I love surgery. He knocked me out, and I love it. And my mom's sobbing in the corner. I'm like so happy that I'm gonna be knocked out for a couple hours. And I get back, and my mom actually plays this Livestrong on my wrist my surgery day, and I never take it off. It breaks sometimes, but I replace it. I think in the course of a week, I counted, and I'm in high school, so I was so nervous about that. I think in the course of a week, I had about 17 people touch my junk, so. 1 week. I didn't even get paid for that. I paid them. That's weird. My chemo experience was actually pretty smooth sailing. I felt sick, but I never threw up. Of course, felt awful the whole time. The first week of chemo, I had a weird craving. When you go through cancer, your taste buds get all messed up, and the chemo kills your taste buds. And so I had weird cravings for food. The first week, I craved quiche. You know, like the cake that's made out of eggs and stuff? Thoughts like that go through my head all the time. I would walk in the chemo office and see people just, you know, sitting there, you know, getting medicine for like 8 hours. And I would start to talk to them. I talked to this one woman. She was old, really old. And she was lovely. And we talked for about an hour. She was really interested in what I was doing, if I got into college, if I was actually planning on being successful. And soon after, we fell asleep, because that's what chemo people do, they fall asleep. And I woke up in this like flurry of EMTs rushing to her chair, and they were resuscitating her. And unfortunately, my mom was right next to me, and she was having just about a heart attack watching that. They wheeled her out. It's a lot to take in when you. I feel bad that my chemo experience was actually kind of smooth sailing. Sometimes I feel bad that I'm a survivor, and I see all these wonderful people pass away, and I wish I just had their spot sometimes. Maybe they could be more valuable to everyone else like me. I don't know. Really sad thought. Awful. And I thought long and hard, and Relay for Life puts it in two simple words: fight back. I decided it was my job to fight back for those people that I saw die, those people that I told died, those people that I told survived, and their caregivers. I wanted to do something drastic when I went to college, and I ran into the Illini 4000. I don't know if anyone knows who the Illini 4000 is, but they're a group of bikers, student bikers, cyclists, who raise money for the American Cancer Society. And while doing that, they also ride their bikes from New York to San Francisco, 4,000 miles, Illini 4,000, raising money for cancer, and also interviewing cancer patients, collecting their stories, and creating profiles of cancer across the nation. It's kind of cool. So I decided to do it, and I'm not a biker. I was so out of shape when I did it. I rarely work out. And so that was awesome that they got this really out of shape, skinny blonde man to try out for their team. And I managed to raise $7,500 for the American Cancer Society alone. And the team my year raised $115,000. And this year the team is celebrating their $500,000 mark of amount that they've risen, and I think that's absolutely amazing. I'm so happy for them. And now I'm trying to find other ways to fight back. Sometimes I go to the hospital and I just sit with a chemo patient and talk with them. Sometimes they don't want to talk about cancer. Sometimes they want to hear what stupid things you do in college, so I tell them. Sorry. And I'm trying to figure out something else that I can do, something more. I'm always trying to figure out what I can do to fight back. And I thought about fight back, and you don't have to do something drastic like the I4K. You don't have to do something drastic like go through cancer. You don't even have to know anyone who's going through cancer to fight back. All you have to do is love yourself, I say. I always told my mom to get a mammogram, and that's a version of fighting back. What else? I tell little kids if they want to fight back, they just help their mom around the kitchen, and that's really cute. Quit smoking. That's a huge one. And the last thing I try to do to fight back is try to make cancer a regular conversation. If you find someone wearing a survivor sash, talk to them about their story. They want to share their story and share their story with your friends and family. The more you talk about cancer, the more you can do about cancer. The more you do about cancer, the faster we can approach some sort of a cure, some sort of hope for cancer patients. They also want me to read this thing. I'm a bad reader too. We all come to Relay for basic reasons. We may have fought cancer ourselves and watched someone we love battle the disease. We relay to celebrate the lives of those who have celebrated cancer, oh my goodness, battled cancer, and emerged victorious. At the same time, we also celebrate the lives of people we've lost. We relay to find comfort and healing from others who have experienced the same loss and understand our grief. In both celebrating the lives of those who we love and remembering those who we've lost, we are motivated to do something, anything, to make sure no one else we care about, no one else we know, has to face this disease. We are here together to fight back. We have joined together from all over this campus, even West Virginia. I met someone from West Virginia here. That's kind of nuts. All over this cancer, traded our orange in for Relay Purple, and together we are taking this day and night to make a statement about our commitment to creating more hope in a cancer-free world. Thanks for your participation, and thank you for fighting back.
So I just wanted to finish off this video by saying that I'm really glad that I chose to participate in Relay for Life this year. I'm kind of upset that there are only three of us from our group, but at the same time, there were hundreds and hundreds of students that came together tonight. Even their parents came. Some people were here from Virginia or West Virginia. Just, I don't know. I volunteered at a breast cancer relay in high school, and even that was life-changing, just handing out waters to the racers. But this, just everyone coming together, I can't even describe it. And anyone watching this video, if you ever have the chance to do anything like this, do it, because everyone is affected by cancer in one way or another, and it's unavoidable in some cases. And we have to keep fighting until we find a cure.